So there's an anime that I finished recently that I've really wanted to talk about, but I'm unsure on how to go about it because I want to do a review, but I also want to really talk about it and kind of break it down and get a little bit more in depth, get the spoilers and all that stuff in there. But also giving this show a review, like giving it a number out of 10, feels weird. It's one of those shows that I don't think just a simple review really does it justice. Because season 1 and season 2 of this anime are just outstanding. Like, season 1 is completely different than season 2. But Vinland Saga will forever stand amongst the greats and will probably go down as one of the best animes ever made. The sun. It's unfortunate because a lot of people probably dropped season 2.
What?
I do understand why. There is kind of a reason I understand. I was going to say a good reason, but I don't think it's a good reason. It's a reason that I understand, though. Because season 1 was like action-packed. A lot of blood, a lot of gore. And with that, there was a lot going on in regards to the story. There were a lot of pieces being moved. There were a lot of twists and turns in season 1. Like, it wasn't just a straight up action packed blood fest, but it had a lot of thought put into it. And by the end of it, you definitely found yourself thinking. Like, it was very thought provoking anime. Vinland Saga is about a boy named Thorfinn who watches his father get murdered in front of him. I think he's about 7 when it happens. Happens in an ambush style. It's pretty badass. But Thorfinn doesn't think that, obviously. And he vows to get revenge on the guy who was really the one to kill his father, and that is Askeladd. So he becomes a stowaway on Askeladd's ship.
Oh no! What'll we do?
I'm gonna kill you!
And ends up joining his crew in order so that basically, like, he gets trained by Askeladd and his crew. Askeladd will be like, okay, go kill this guy or go do that. And he'll go and do it in order to get a chance to fight and duel him in a one-on-one so that he can kill him to get his revenge. But every time this happens and he thinks he's strong enough to kill him, Thorfinn gets destroyed and does not win. He becomes this just like one note, one thought machine of just, he just wants to kill Askeladd. And it gets to a point actually where you're like, why? Shut up. Like, because it becomes more clear as you get into the anime that this is not as it seems. Askeladd really isn't doing this out of hatred. He's not really toying with Thorfinn as it seems, but he's doing it out of love. And he's doing it because he wants him to grow and get out of this whole cycle of vengeance, not to save himself. And it's fucking crazy, which is another reason why, like, the anime is so good, because it's not just, again, I'm talking about season 1 still, but season 1 is not just mindless violence. There are a lot of story that goes on behind it. And Askeladd, even in my opinion, kind of becomes the main character. And Thorfinn gets not backseated, but it's just, you just become annoyed with him. You're like, man, you gotta like grow up and kind of get over it and really see what this guy's trying to do. And he has an overarching plan for like the world, and not for like world domination or anything, but for true justice. And you just keep trying to kill him, and he's trying to explain it to you, but it's a read between the lines type of thing. And he really becomes like a father figure to Thorfinn, but this is not realized until the last episode. This is just everything. I'm gonna have to talk about spoilers because, like I said earlier, I don't actually think giving this a rating out of 10 is appropriate. But basically, at the end of season 1, the last episode, which I didn't even realize, if you pay attention, it's called End of the Prologue, which I did not know. And that's very, very important for season 2, because if you understand that season 1 is the prologue, it makes season 2 a lot easier to digest because it's like night and day. But at the end of season 1, Askeladd is killed and Thorfinn watches it happen, and he's not the one to do it. As he drops his dagger, which I swear he is not, the whole thing is that he hasn't dropped that thing since he's gotten it. He has been using that fucking thing to try to kill Askeladd and kill anyone who came in between him. And he finally drops it and his like whole life flashes before his eyes. And then what? What is he then? That's all he was. That was his one goal, his one purpose. What's left? you know? That's what you're left with. What is left of Thorfinn? By the end, you're just jealous that Thorfinn had two fathers. But Thorfinn does not realize this until season two. If you are expecting anything like season one, no, that's not it. That revenge story is over. When you see Thorfinn in episode one, he has become a slave. He's like a farmer, like a slave farmer. Yeah, I'm pretty sure at that point he's cutting down trees and he is a hollow shell of a man. He is not the same. You can tell immediately. You see him at like the end of the first episode and he is not the same person at all. Like in season one, it's described to me as a farming simulator, and that is so true. But by golly, at first you're like, okay, this is fine, I can deal with this. And then it's like, but yes, it does make sense. They need that horse so they can plow more land faster, because the faster they plow the land, they gotta plow the land before winter so that they can get the most out of the crops. And you're like with them in it, you know, you're with them in the shits, because these two guys are slaves and they're trying to buy their freedom essentially. So if they can make enough crops to sell, then they can buy their freedom. And that's kind of like an overarching throughout the whole season. But then Thorfinn is also dealing with everything he did throughout season one. He never sleeps. He always has nightmares. And he is basically like, if season one is about vengeance, hatred, anger, season two is about redemption, forgiveness, insightfulness. I don't know if that's really a word to be putting in here, but you know what I mean? Like, he really looks into himself. It's very spiritual in a weird way. I'm not even like that really, but just the character development they do with not just Thorfinn, everyone else, but really it's mainly Thorfinn, like the development, that character, it is so grounded in reality. And so I've never seen it in anime before. I've never seen that before. Show me another anime like Vinland Saga. I don't think you can. Not only is it grounded in reality, because some of the characters are actually real, like explorers in real life, and they find like Iceland and wait, I don't want to fuck this part up. Like, it's a series about the Vikings, and they find like there's like Denmark, Iceland, Greenland, Vinland's Newfoundland, which I love. So not only is the actual anime historically grounded in reality, but you will not find moments that are the typical anime moments, you know what I mean? Where there's actually one episode where I did comment on at the very end of season two, where, example, a character is picked up and, you know, they're shook. And the character gets little, they get tiny, and then they're like, oh, what are you doing? And they're like shaking them. And their character's flipping back and forth, and they like throw them, and they get thrown and do like a million flips and go into the galaxy or something, you know what I mean? And then they're like totally fine in the next scene. Like, that stuff, those silly things, like, do not happen in this anime whatsoever, in season one or season two. The only time it ever happens is the very last episode of season two, which I thought was poetic in a weird way. You have no sense of safety throughout all season one and two, and then the last episode, they really give you a good cushion to make you feel satisfied, and it's, you can relax and actually, like, everyone's safe. Everyone's truly safe now. Getting all over the place. My brain's a little whacked, but, like, this anime is so good. Season two, I grew with that character. There was a point where I wanted Thorfinn to fight someone and he chose not to. And I thought about that for so long. I just thought about that moment for so long. Like, wow, this is this anime. This is what it is. Like, that is, I really expected him to fucking fight that guy, and he didn't. He chose not to. He chose not violence. And I remember there's a quote, which I don't think is a spoiler at all.
You want to learn about somebody interesting? Thorfinn, famously known to have proclaimed he has no enemies.
And I didn't even understand what that meant until in the anime he says it, and it is so powerful to see that character, where you know he came from, to where, like I said, one note, he would kill you if you were in his way, doesn't matter who you are, to refusing violence and confidently saying, like, I have no enemies, like, that is a world that he wants, and it was just so powerful. There is action in season two, don't get me wrong, but not like season one. Season one's base is a ton of action, but season two, the action is placed like very methodically. Thorfinn maybe chooses violence, you know, but not, that's like a last resort. And he makes that clear where one time he chooses violence and then he's like, no, this is not, this has to be the very last resort. What I do really like is he has a unique fighting style anyways, like in season one, and it's noted in season two, a character's like, oh, what kind of stance is that? And they kind of do a stance, you're like, oh. I just think season one and two are, there's such a good story. Not that it's over now after season two, but it, I feel genuinely satisfied. You may feel like it was boring, but I feel like this was like a growth. This was a story about growth, forgiveness, not just for other people, but forgiveness in yourself. Like, this anime really digs deep. It's not afraid to go into those very heavy emotional themes of trauma and guilt and shame. You should see some of the ways that his guilt and shame are manifested, like physically in his dreams, in when he's not dreaming. Oh man, such an emotional anime, man. Oh my god, I watched it with my buddy and it just almost heightened the experience. There was one episode I remember turning to my friend and going, that felt like a really long episode. And for a good reason, because there's this character death and wow, it's so long and I don't even know how to describe it. It's so beautiful. Like, they do not hold back on some characters' final moments in a good way. Like, for a show that, oh man, when the violence gets going, like, they'll cut people in half, cut their bodies in a weird way, like decapitation, all their limbs cut off, like shit gets gory. But when they send off certain characters, it is beautiful. I'm sitting in the corner and my buddy's over there and I'm like having to turn away because I'm just like fucking crying because it's just so sad, but in a beautiful way. I think it'd be very easy to drop this anime and not give it a chance. And I think that that is very unfortunate. And I think that if you're willing to, first of all, realize season one is the prequel. Season one is warming you up for what's to come. Because though this is a story about going to Vinland, that's the whole point of the story. It's still the point of the story right now. But it's very much like, it's very much a character growth story. Seeing the way Thorfinn handles all these different situations and how you literally see him from, I think it's age 7 to 20. I think, how old is Thorfinn in the last episode? Yeah, so he's 19 at the beginning of the arc and 22 by the end of it. And I'm pretty sure he's 7. Because I'm pretty sure he says at the beginning they like go off to war, but they're not really going off to war. Like it's not that complicated. It's kind of complicated. And like I said, it really isn't just Thorfinn. Like, there's another character who I haven't even brought up. His name's Knut. And his growth is the opposite of Thorfinn's. Like, he goes from season one, he's supposed to be like, he's a prince and he's supposed to be the king, and he's gotta fucking be more of a king, and he's not. And he has a hard time making hard decisions. He can't really fight. He can't do anything. He just has a hard time. Askeladd basically puts him in scenarios where he has to, because Askeladd's whole master plan is to put him into power because the actual king is bad. So Askeladd kills the king and then forces the prince to kill Askeladd so that the people will then be behind him. So he pulls this kind of like noble act so that Knut can be the king and to kind of fix stuff. It definitely makes the people on Canute's side, but Canute, that changes him. It does not change him for the good. It makes him like Thorfinn season one, where he is out for blood. He is out to take land. He is the king. Like, he's the king of Denmark and the king of England, where you would not have expected. Like, the way he's introduced in season two is extremely ruthless. Up until the building point of him and Thorfinn meeting in season two is, once you realize that these two characters are going to meet after what happened in season one, because Knut killed Askeladd. Thorfinn wanted to kill Askeladd. Thorfinn then realized, well, actually, Askeladd was like my dad. He realizes that in season two, you know? So when you realize, oh my god, he's gonna go see Knut in season two, like, there's just so much, oh my god, there's just so much depth. I could go on. I feel like I'm maybe getting too in-depth of the kind of things that I'm explaining, but I really could talk about this anime for so long. It is magnificent. I could not give it a number out of 10, but this thing is just, it's so beautiful. And I feel like I grew with it. And there are so many animes that are just action-packed that you can watch and it's just like slash, hack and slash. I bring up Demon Slayer a lot, but there are a lot of animes like Demon Slayer. That's why people hack on the story, because there are a lot of similar animes, you know? There is one Vinland Saga. There is one anime that chooses to go so deep. So watch it if you haven't. If you gave up on season two, I highly recommend having more patience. Unless you're not invested into the character of Thorfinn, then it maybe won't matter. I don't know. Give season one maybe a rewatch. Try season two. Now that's out, you can binge it, right? But I thought that was just peak. That is peak. So don't sleep on Vinland Saga, please. I could continue, I think. Don't be like me with One Piece. Don't be afraid of the change. Don't be afraid of something different. Watch Vinland Saga. And yes, I am watching One Piece. That's what that means. But that doesn't matter. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk about Vinland Saga. And if you like that video and are still here, then you should come to my channel, Just Jacob, and see what else I got in store. I got some more video game essays rocking and rolling. I'm playing Tears of the Kingdom as well, Water and Wind Temple out right now, and I got some anime game movie reviews and some new stuff. But until next time.